And the magic word this week is a tree fell on her. A tree fell on her.
Good evening.
My name is John Wells, gross take-home pay £9.12, plus 18 shillings for each child.
This brings his money up to £498.06.
We must operate at once.
The pill, is it potent and does it? Hear what a Roman Catholic priest said.
Two packets, please.
You see, Doctor, we've had 23 children in 20 years.
We must operate at once.
You see, my husband and I do not wish to take the pill because we are Coman Rathlicks.
Look, I want you to take a glass of orange juice every night on going to bed.
Before or after?
Instead of...
No, no, whatever that you wish.
To take the pill or not to take the pill, we put this delicate question to a random assortment of practicing sex maniacs. One said, another said, and another said, thus giving us two Ave Maria, putting the Catholics behind. We asked the same question of a cosmopolitan assortment of part-time Protestants.
Madam, do you take the pill?
Yes.
Why?
Because I like the taste.
Why do you take the pill?
Well, it passes the time. I always keep a packet handy. They help me concentrate on the job. Terribly refreshing.
It stopped me smoking.
Sailor.
There's a lot of it about.
Are you getting yours?
I wonder what the folks back home are doing.
We're not doing anything.
The calling in of firearms and watery legs has not prevented attacks on perfectly innocent people. However, you do not need a license for a custard pie. And this has not gone unnoticed by the underworld. Under the cover of pastry, the first attack took place. Date, November 10th. Place, National Gallery. 10 minutes later, the Speaker of the House of Lords. Following this, another attack. Then, in quick succession, David Frost, Huey Green, and almost... Mafia-inspired attacks were made on Russia's Khrushchev, Francis de Gaulle, and America's own Cassius Clay. The police want to interview this man. They warn that he may be armed. He may be left armed, or he may be right armed, or he may be short armed.
Is he Jewish?
Everybody's Jewish!
Tense, frustrated, let instant husband help you. No mess, no fuss, just satisfaction.
It ruined my marriage.
Come in. Good morning, madam. May we come in?
Yes.
Thank you. My name is Ernest Squonk, ace salesman, and this is my fellow director. You must excuse his diminutive proportions, but on the way here, guess what happened?
What?
A tree fell on him. Madam, we're very worried about your child's education.
Oh?
Oh, I mean, are you satisfied with him?
Who?
Who? Your child's education. That's you.
Well, he is way down at school.
He's way down at school, madam, you see. He's way down at school. What he needs, madam, is the entire weight of the knowledge of the world behind him.
Oh, is that them?
That is them, madam. I mean, for instance, does your child know that the Japanese crapo fly can walk backwards on one leg at 2 miles an hour?
He never tells me anything.
He never tells you anything, madam. He never tells you anything. Another thing, madam, do you know what the intellectual jet set are saying?
No, I don't know what they're saying.
The Hanging Gardens of Babylon, 2001 BC onwards.
Oh, is that what they're saying?
That's what they're saying, madam. That's what they're saying. That's what the knowledge of the world is saying, madam.
Oh, well, I've just made a cup of tea.
Tea? Like tea. Grown on the slopes of the Negri Hills, altitude 3,000 feet.
I get mine at the co-op.
Oh.
Ahem.
Madam, I think I should draw attention to something you may not know. The Colossus of Rhodes.
Oh, the Minister of Transport.
No, you're wrong, madam. You see, that's where ignorance is wrong. No, the Minister of Transport is not the Colossus of Rhodes. No, the Minister of Transport is a giant nude statue bestriding the port of Alexandria.
Fancy. What will I think of next?
I'll tell you what I'll think of next, madam. I'd like you to examine this knowledge of the world. Open it at random.
Random. Rand, Randy, Random. Haussmann von Random. German bladder manipulator. 1857-1759. Died of the grip.
You see, madam, you already have the edge over the neighbours. Now tell me, madam. Tell me, madam. Would you be interested in buying the entire set of the chronologies of the world?
Well, not today.
Tomorrow, then. Look, madam, while we wait, your child's mind is flaring in ignorance, madam.
Yes.
Shut up. Look, madam, I can see you're busy. Would you be interested in our spring economy pack A to B inclusive?
How much?
Two guineas per vol.
I've only got 30 bob.
30 bob. 2 shillings. 4 bob. 6 bob. 8. I wonder what the folks back home are doing.
They aren't doing anything.
The police took a number of names and addresses. They also took several boxes of postcards, a film projector, and several appliances. There's a police recruiting station in your town.
Today I'm taking part in a most extraordinary court case which is being held this week at the Magistrates Court, Paddington. The Right Honourable Judge himself, replayed by John Wells, and I, and arriving here on time.
Will the prostitution commence?
My lord, I hope to prove that by negligence, Steam Dick's Turkish bath caused such a considerable personality change in my client that not even his own mother recognized him.
Did she ever recognize him?
No, my lord, a tree fell on her.
Oh. How was this change wrought?
Well, he was changed for considerable substance to a liquefied form.
When you say liquefied form, is he, dead?
We don't know, Your Honour.
What do you mean you don't know? Either he's dead or he's not dead.
Well, may I give you your indulgence, my
lord? Is he in court?
Yes.
Well, call him, then.
Oh, Larry Seacombe!
Oh, Larry Seacombe!
Are you Harry Seacombe?
No. I'm Police Constable Zed Cars. Gross take-home pay, £14, 4 shillings and 9 pence. With repeats, £32, 4 and 4 pence. You see, I just carry the bucket.
May I clarify? In that bucket is my plaintiff, Harry Seacombe.
All of him?
Yes.
What's he doing?
Nothing. He's lying quietly in the bottom. May I elucidate?
If you must, but I must warn you, it can cause blindness.
Thank you, my lord. My lord, on the 1st of April, which is by way of being a Jewish holiday in Morecambe and Wise, my client attended Steam Dick's Turkish Bath. Mm-hmm. There he was shown to a chamber, stripped, and left to steam.
To steam?
Steam, Your Honor.
You're not going to tell me a tree fell on him.
No, my lord. Something far worse. Something far worse. A faulty valve forced the heat in his chamber to rise to some 800 degrees centigrade. The melting point of the human body.
Good lord.
An assistant rushed in, but alas, too late. Mr. Seacombe now lay in a puddle on the floor. The assistant, being a sensitive man, mopped him up with a sponge and rug him out into a bucket. That bucket.
Silence, I will not have under-rehearsed mumbling in this court. Can we see Mr. Seacombe?
Constable, will you pour out the plaintiff?
Good old Larry.
And you are suing for negligence?
No, I'm not suing for negligence. We're suing for short measure, my lord. According to the forensic report, on entering the steam baths, my client Harry Seacombe weighed 19 stone 10 pounds and gaining all the time. According to a rough conversion table, that should work out at 8.5 imperial Welsh pence. May I draw the court's attention to this barely 6 pence.
And we are saying that Mr. Seacombe is deficient by 2.5 imperial Welsh green pence.
Yes, my lord.
Well, can't we top him up with a little tap water?
I'm afraid not. It's against his religion. And now... the defense rests.
Call Aristotle Onassis.
And now in my new role as consenting male announcer, the very real and very disturbing problem of smoking pot. When you buy a packet of pots, you are on the threshold of a new hallucinatory experience. Just look at this film. Real groovy man. That experience was achieved without the help of any drug at all. All it needed was a piano, a pianist, an old lady, and an out-of-work plumber.
Breathe in. Out. Say ah. Ah. Sit down. I'm very sorry.
Is it bad, Doctor?
It's very bad, I'm afraid.
Doctor, please, you must tell me. I must know the truth.
Lady Teasel.
Yes, Doctor.
Your husband's suspicions are well-founded. You suffered a severe Shakespeare.
It's the third time this week. What causes it?
Elephants.
You mean I've got elephants?
Yes, you've got them low down where they're very expensive.
Doctor, please, are you sure I've got elephants?
Look at this slide of your blood.
Good heavens!
Look out! Run for it! He's seen us, Mr. Seacombe!
Pam, zap, zowie.
There is no need for you to suffer with elephants anymore. My company, I See Eye to Eye, have come up with a brilliant new formula. Here's how to keep your family healthy and elephant-free. $3.99 a box.
Good evening. So no longer is the jet set confined to the King's Road. Some confinements are taking place in Queen Charlotte's, and even these are spreading. Now, the center of hippiedom, of course, is now in Neasden, the gateway to NW10. And the guru of this newfound establishment has installed himself, I beg your pardon, I should say, has enthroned himself in the new love nest at number 3 Clack Lane, Ryslip, a rather misleading name to such a Valhalla of erotica.
Don't let this homely facade fool you. Behind this photograph lives the guru, to give Ned Teeth his full name, who's brought a strange mystic beauty to these otherwise drab surroundings. Her name, the Honourable Letitia Body, heiress to a car park empire.
I'll get in these vibrations.
I'll get in these vibrations.
Just a minute.
No.
Just a minute, man.
Yes.
Like I'm on gas now, man.
Has Ned Teeth always been your name, guru?
No. He used to be Ernest Fred Peraldi. But it was too loud, so I changed it to shorten it and... I shortened it to Ned.
And so he shortened it to Ned, a name that is redolent of mysticism. Guru Teeth, prior to your finding your newfound metaphysical manifestation, what were you?
I was a trainee embalmer at Leaf Crematorium. But there was... it bugged me, man. It bugged me. No. Child, there's no one... there was no outlet for me natural talent, you see.
I see. And what were your talents?
I could play a vibe of me on the bones.
I see. And you come from a musical family?
No, that's the funny part. I don't know where I get it. Oh, man, I'm flying, man.
So, I see. So then you left the crematorium?
Yes, sir. It bugged me, man. I wanted to get onto a new scene. There they go.
Guru Teeth, for the less knowledgeable, could you tell us what music is that?
That's your mystic Indian raga.
I see, and... this is a record, is it?
No, it's a bunch of wogs in the next room.
You mean Commonwealth immigrants?
No, this is a bunch of wogs in the next room.
I see.
Guilty. What? Oh, man, I'm on it now, yes, man. Where's the partner? Come see it clean, man.
Yes, I see. I mean, I'm rather interested here. Without any physical contact, yes. How do you make them play?
Well, you see that mystic hole in the wall? Well, every hour, a bunk to a tin of pussycat meat. One tin for the raga, and 2 tin for Sergeant Pepper's Curried Lonely Hearts Band.
Later, we spoke to the guru's spiritual consort, the Honourable Letitia Body. Miss Body, when did you first contact the guru?
We met by accident. He ran over me in a dust cart. At the time, he was the assistant guru to the Hendon Public Cleansing Department.
I see, and was he Jewish?
Yes, he was.
I see, and your function now?
Oh, I am his handmaiden. I give him my all.
She gives him her all.
Oh, she don't give that. Yeah, every morning she comes, little darling. Yes. Every morning she comes into the dressing room, nothing on. You know what she gives me? Check for 10,000 quid.
I see, and in return, what do you give her?
I slip her a receipt.
He slips her a receipt.
Here he is.
That's the washing up water, you twit.
And that was the washing up water, you twit.
No. Let me explain to you, sir. Let me explain. The guru is washing his hands in anticipation of smoking.
Massive up. Oh, baby. What? You want a trip?
What are they?
What buns?
And there we must leave the guru and his teeth and, of course, his flock. Anyone wishing to make contact with the guru, write to Swami Ned Teeth, 13 Tariq Alley, just off the Letsby Avenue, London, NW10. God save our gracious Queen.
Long
and there we leave the guru, a man of many religious convictions, three of which are pending.
This is a recorded announcement. Ours is the age of new recording gimmicks. Jimi Hendrix, wigs. Sandy Shaw, no shoes. Tessie O'Shea, no drawers. One away and three in the wash. One late result, John Lennon won, Coca-Cola lost. Every possible permutation has been exploited, so the need for originality becomes more and more wax pressing, wax pressing, wax pressing.
This man is Cedric Lunge, who has signed a contract with a recording company to leap off Beachy Head and sing Ave Maria before he hit the rocks below. He was killed outright. This was a flagrant breach of contract. The company sued the family for the remainder of the song.
So the son, Hercules Lunge, took up the challenge to clear his father's name. Let us recap. Now, Cedric Lunge from point A, he managed to sing three bars of Ave Maria before hitting point B. Contractually, he was 29 bars short and dead. Now, this meant that Hercules Lunge's descent was a superb idea. A pair of parachute socks. Now, several tests were made using a weighted body called Hercules Lunge.
All set then for the second attempt. Another breach of contract. The record company was losing its patience. The Lunge family was losing its people. But then into the breach has stepped Aristotle Lunge, the great-great-great-grandson of Cedric, the first of the singing, jumping, and dying Lunges.
And as you can see, he's broken his training, both legs, an arm, and his neck to be with us tonight. With him is his trainer, Tom Danger. Now, I wonder if you could tell us in your own words, Aristotle, what exactly you're up to?
I feel I have a destiny to fulfill.
Could you elaborate on that?
Yes.
How many bars are there left of the elusive Ave Maria to complete?
13.
Isn't that often considered an unlucky number?
Nah. You took my first marriage, 13th of July. The first wife, she gets killed. Tree fell her. 2 years later, second wife, she gets killed, 13th of July. Tree fall on her. And then the third wife, 13th of July, she gets killed.
Don't tell me a tree fell on her.
No. She died in bed.
What happened?
A tree fell on her.
How exactly are you training, Mr. Lunge?
Well, you see, you've got to harden up his nut for the rocks he's going to encounter when he jumps out. So every morning I set him off singing Ave Maria. Then he drops off on the way to rocks on his nut. And that's it.
What effect does that have on him?
A lasting one.
I see. In other words?
I don't know any other words.
Are you Jewish?
Am I Jewish? No. A tree fell on me. You see, what we do is this. Every night, I hang him up on a meat hook upside down with his nut in a bucket of brine. And we revolve him all night slowly with a dog tied to a lead. Round he goes. In the morning, I turn him up the other way, and then I massage his nut with an iron bar dipped in nut. That matters, yeah. Then we give him another underweight of rocks on his nut. Then I give him half an hour's belt of an iron bar. Then he has his breakfast.
What does he have for breakfast?
What does he have for breakfast? Another belting.
I see. And do you think this belting on the nut does the trick?
No.
Well, why do you do it then?
I don't like him.
Well, as you see.
Now then, time for another workout, anybody? Chaps. Are you ready? Get the rocks on.
Must operate at once. Why? If I want to make a living.
Respirations?
Normal.
Pulse?
Normal.
Right, let's start now. Scalpel? Scalpel. Venal clips?
Venal clips.
swabs? Swabs.
Oh, blast.
Oh, blast.
Swaps. How much did it?
And now here is your chance to win a plate of funny gravy. Here's what you have to do.
And send the bits to the mortuary, Leeds Crematorium, Hull.
Trouble seems so far away. Now, it's as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm just half the man I used to. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why she had to go, I don't know, she wouldn't say. I said something wrong. Yesterday. All my troubles seem so far, far away. Now I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe. In yesterday. Yesterday. I believe.